sounds like you grew up in the midst of, there were lots of black people. Is that right? Where you were?
There was one white family in a whole area, let's say 8 miles in each direction. And I was the first white child that had been born there in 32 years in that area. That's the reason God all the babies to see me, and they all loved me. And people had even asked me, well, you come from way down south. I guess you hate the niggers, don't you? I said, wait a minute. I'll straighten out on one word before I give you an answer. Now, that word that you just used is used, but it's used for a very special occasion. When one black man is definitely and positively angry, fighting angry with another one, he'll call him that for sure. Otherwise, you tread lightly on that word. You say that to him. But now, do I hate them? Well, if I told you something negative or positive, that's all the answer you would have. I'll tell you a little story. See, I like stories.
Before the Civil War, educational opportunities for Negroes was almost non-existent. Free Negroes in Nashville did operate some classes and schools clandestinely between 1833 and 1857 until they were shut down by vigilantes in January of 1857 because of recent race riots in the city of Nashville.
Recently, we learned about sundown towns in Appalachia, right? Specifically, we learned about Corbin, which is a small town near the East Tennessee-Kentucky border on the Kentucky side. So Corbin used to be a sundown town, and sundown towns are places where black people were not allowed past sunset, right? So once the sun went down, they had to get the hell up out of there, right? And so there would be these huge signs, like this is how people knew this was a sundown town. There would be these huge signs like at the town's entrance or some main road leading up to the town. And they would read some version of, nigger, don't let the sun set on your black ass in blank town, right? And we know that in East Tennessee, there was one of these sundown towns.
Yeah, and in post-Reconstruction America, these types of towns weren't just in the traditional South. They were also in a lot of those in the Midwest, Indiana, in
Chicago,
right. Out West, and in the Northeast. I mean, think about these sundown towns were all over the place. Here in our region, places like Irwin, Tennessee, Grundy, Virginia, and Corbin, Kentucky. And Corbin, Kentucky is one of those places that once I started driving, my dad gave me the talk, we don't go over there. You don't go over there.
So Jim Crow laws were racially discriminating laws that meant to keep the whites and blacks separate, but also to keep the black Tennesseans subordinate, that they really were, according to Jim Crow laws, not full-fledged citizens. Tennessee had a law, 1867, that forbid the teaching and learning of students of white and black race in the same school. So,
suppose you had been, let's think of a little girl about, say, 9 years old. And a big black man, big, tall, strong black man had slapped you as far as from here to yonder into a blackberry patch and didn't even come to see whether you were all right or not. How would you feel about it?
Not too bad.
All right, if we stop the story there, that's all there is to it, isn't it? But why didn't he come to see that, whether that little girl was all right?
You have to fill that in.
Well, rivers flood. And if they flood in July or any part of the summer, there's enough water to go everywhere and do all sorts of trouble. There were a group of people coming from the other side of the river to the side of the river where that little girl was. They were coming in a flatboat. The water was rushing. One woman had drowned the day before. Everybody was tense about it. But little children, 5 and 9 years old, don't always see the danger in other poor folks are busy. And the little girl and her brother were there watching what was going on. And for some reason, the little girl ran across under this big tree and didn't even notice that it was being uprooted and ready to go in the river. The man slapped her. Now, had he followed behind her, he would have gone in the river. But he stepped back and saved his life, and the little girl was saved over there. But why didn't he come on around that abyss and see about it? Everybody there was hugging him. The little girl was all right. She'd had bras in her before. That was no problem. She loved him and all his people.
So was that little girl you?
It certainly was. My daddy was one of the folks that was there. Nobody came to see about me. I was all right. If they had gone across the place that I had run across, they would have gone into the river. So the good Lord stopped their feet over there to show appreciation to that man. But I have no problem with black people.
We turn now to the award-winning musical polymath Rhiannon Giddens, a folk singer and multi-instrumentalist. Giddens grew up in North Carolina, and she's also a classically trained opera singer. She's on a mission to reframe the history of African Americans and their contributions to the musical landscape, a quest that's already won her a MacArthur Genius Grant. Rhiannon sat down with our Walter Isaacson to discuss her latest album, There Is No Other, and to play some banjo.
You have this amazing new album called There Is No Other. Mm. And it's about diversity and different strains coming together. Mm. First, let me ask you about your own personal ancestry.
My parents got married in North Carolina, interracial couple, got married, three years after a loving decision.
In other words, that allowed interracial marriage mm-hmm. in North Carolina.
Yeah. I grew up kind of going back and forth between my white side and my black side. And then kind of as the years would pass, you kind of hear these hints of, stories about Indian blood and this and that and kind of going, all right. And then I started kind of getting interested in that side of things,
So Native American background that you mm-hmm. had too.
And so I got interested in that side of things at the high school that I went to. There was a Native American drumming group there called a Quago and a powwow that happens there every year. And so I learned how to sing powwow songs and, really just kind of explored that just for my own self.
Where is this?
This was in Durham, North Carolina.
North
Carolina School of Science and Mathematics. I'm not looking for any kind of validation or claiming a particular kind of this or that. It's kind of like, well, I'm a mix. And I think the best of American music comes from that aspect of it, the mixture. And so that's kind of what I've been doing with my music in America, like looking particularly at the African-American part of things, because in the music that I've been interested in, it's been sort of suppressed, the true role of black Americans in the creation of some of these things like, country music, old time music, bluegrass, things that are at the heart of a lot of what is really American. And so I've been doing that for some years, and this record, There Is No Other, it was an opportunity to place that in a global context.
And it talks about the ties that bind us as well.
Exactly.
My dad gave me the talk like we don't go over there. Like, right. You don't go over there.
Y'all, William doesn't listen to his dad. And he, funny enough, he took us over to Corbin. We all went down to, or went up.
We did go over
there. We went over to Corbin. Yes, we did. And so after our visit, we wanted to learn more about Corbin. So we found out that 0.05% of 7,200 people in Corbin are black. like, how cool would it be if we found, you know, like, one of those Black people from Corbin?
What if I did?
Shut up.
Now I'm dead ass serious.
You found, what you
if
found,
I did?
You found the Black people in Corbin?
Sort of. The, like, 0.6.
What do you mean?
Like, she's biracial, but she lives in Corbin.
You found our 0.6.
Yes. Okay. You know my Facebook stays lit, so I had decided to make a post the other day, and I just asked everyone on my friends list, does anyone know anyone in Corbin, Kentucky? And I actually got some responses, and they tagged this one girl in particular named Camilla.
Get out.
Yeah, so she's the 0.6.
Wow. Okay, so what does Camilla have to say about Corbin? Like, how did she end up there?
Hello.
Hey, it's Angela.
Hey, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good.
So we just wanted to call you because we are doing a podcast on Black history in Appalachia. You said you currently live in Corbin, is that correct?
I do. I've lived in Corbin for about 3.5 or 4 years. My husband and I decided that we were going to move to Corbin to buy a home and kind of put some roots down. And I remember telling our parents and my dad, he just kind of, at first he kind of looked a little shocked, a little look of shock on his face. And he said, you know, Corbin used to be bad. The one thing that he said he always remembered is there was a certain point this way that my grandfather would turn the truck around. Because it literally said no N-words allowed,
right,
across a bridge. And he said that that's just something that's always stuck with him. And so I think he was just scared for us. But he was just like, it used to be really bad, and I just worry about you being safe.
Do you feel that association with Black people early in your life, do you think that an influence on how your interests developed?
Well, it didn't just start that day. But that's the thing that people can understand when I tell them. If I just said, oh no, they've always been our friends. Now, when my little sister was about to die one night with the croup, and Aunt Susan was Black, maybe they lived about as far as from here, though. Maybe the traffic light down there. Came to ask my mama if there's anything she could do. She said, well, I guess we've done all for the baby we can do. But we can take Mary and see that she's looked after until things get better. Where did I sleep that night?
In her house?
Not only in her house. She had one bed, one husband and one boy. The four of us in that bed. I was right here. Nat was holding on to me because she loved me dearly, to be sure I didn't fall out of the bed. Charlie, her husband, was next, and Matt Boy was next. And the next morning, when we went to the house to see how things were, Kitty was much better, and she lived. And I said, I'm having a good time. And one of the men said, she's all right. We're looking after her. So I got to stay down there until it was noontime. I was appreciated, and I appreciated them. So we had no problem with Black people.
I mean, it's like, for me, it's multiple things. You know, one is the assumption that all of this music starts in Appalachia, which is just not true. Two is that there were no Black people in Appalachia, which is also not true. So those are two enormously huge assumptions to make and really skew the story. But, like, he wasn't the only one who did that. I mean, Lomax did it too. I mean, a lot of people who are looking for a narrative ignore everything that's outside of that narrative because, you know, and it doesn't take away from the work they did. It doesn't take away from what they saved. But it does frustrate you when you think about what they left out. Well summed up what Cecil Sharp left out of the story by a movie called Songcatcher, which kind of like takes that story of people finding this connection between these Victorian songs and in England and the Appalachian Mountains. And so this woman is going to collect songs from the Appalachian Mountains, and she's looking for this ballad singer, and she stops and sees a Black man playing banjo. Which in the film is played by Taj Mahal, right?
Now, you ever have some chickens, you have some hens in the hen house, you know? When you come out there in the morning sometime, after they lay them eggs, you know, they make a funny little sound. Now, they can either cackle when they're nervous, or they cluck when they're quiet and happy. And this is what the clucking sound like on the banjo.
And she stops and asks him where this ballad singer is, and then keeps going. And that, to me, is the story. You know, it's like, oh, hey, black person playing a banjo? Where's the ballad singers? All right, you know, let's forget you now. You know, I mean, that's kind of it. I mean,
Free Negroes in Nashville did operate some classes and schools clandestinely, until they were shut down by vigilantes in January of 1857 because of recent race riots in the city of Nashville. Perhaps 10% of them could read and write a little bit, whereas masters often had to teach them some degree of literacy in those skill trades. Because about 10% of the slaves were urban, and they ran errands for their masters. They worked in their shops, in their offices, and so on. So about 10% of the slaves, we estimate, could read and write a little bit. But illiteracy was not unusual in Tennessee in antebellum times. More than half of the people in the state couldn't read and write.
If I can give them a little story to make it sink in, it's better that way. Oh, there was another tale I was going to tell you. No, it's not a tale, it's a story. A story is not a lie. A story is an accounting of something that happened. And what makes a story become a legend?
Told over and over again.
It's told plural times on down through generations before it's written down. It should be told through people of different ages several times before that. Now, which legends? And it's not a legend, if in that telling the truths are left out, then it loses its status as a legend. It's just a tale. Anything can constitute a tale, just so long it's told and goes on and on like a tale. But now, which legends are myths?
If they have some universal truths.
You're getting pretty close to it. You started to say something else before you said universal.
If they have something to do with spiritual matters too.
Well, that's getting mighty close to it. You're thinking the right way. You haven't decided what words you want to use.
Well, you better just tell us.
Did you ever think about something being more powerful than a human being?
Yep, I have.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Call him anything you want to, or call her anything you want to, call it anything you want to, but it must have in it something more powerful than man.